Hey everyone, it's Sandy Adams, and you're listening to a Southern Girls of You podcast. Hey everyone, and welcome to another podcast episode of A Southern Girls View with me, Sandy Adams. Today, it's October. Can you believe it? The end of the year is near. This is episode 5, and because it's almost Halloween, and because of that it's October, I wanted to talk about a city that kind of somehow it connects itself with Halloween, and that is Salem, Massachusetts. What we learned in history class was that the Salem witch trials occurred there. Today's guest will defunct that myth and talk about the truth behind the witch trials, the actual facts involved around the hysteria that happened. Salem is a historic coastal city in Essex County, Massachusetts. It's located in the North Shore region, about 20 to 45 minutes north of Boston, depending on if you're driving, if you're in the train, whatever. It is a New England bedrock of history, literally, since it was founded in 1626 with its first European settlement, and is considered one of the most significant seaports in Puritan American history. But it also has been defined by the Salem witch trials, which literally only happened for a year and a half, if a year and a half fully. That year and a half has defined a city that has been in existence since 1626. Isn't that crazy? So I asked my friend Shelby Hypes. She lives in Salem, and I've known her for 20 or 30 years. I've stopped counting. And I asked her to come on the show today to talk about the stereotypes associated with Salem, to talk about the witch trials, what really is the truth, what are the facts involved that we know now that we may not have known when we were in history class. I won't tell you how many years ago I was in history class in high school. But I wanted her to talk about the Salem of today. What happens today? What is Salem like? What is Salem known for? If you were to go and visit Salem, Massachusetts, what would you leave? What impression would you leave with? So that's what we're going to talk about today, and I'm so excited to get this episode started. Today, we welcome Shelby Hypes. She is a longtime resident of Salem, Massachusetts, where haunted happenings begin with a big parade on the first Thursday of October and culminate with fireworks to entertain the 100,000-plus people who mobbed the city's downtown on Halloween night itself. Although well-versed in what is known as Witch City, it is the other Salem that she truly champions. The Salem of world-class museums, historic houses, a rich maritime legacy, and a wealth of cultural and charitable organizations. She's been a docent at the Peabody Essex Museum for more than 30 years and is the former chair of Voices Against Injustice, which keeps alive the lessons of the trials as stewards of the Salem Witch Trials Memorial, and by advocating for social justice today. She has served on many local boards of directors and spearheaded Salem's Black Heritage audio tour. So today's guest is Shelby Hypes. And Shelby, welcome to the show.
Thank you. I am delighted to be here.
So this is the month of October, and we've been trying to connect for a few weeks now to talk about a city that I have visited many years ago, probably 20 plus years ago, and I just fell in love with it for the brief day that I was there. So just to kind of start off, were you born and raised in Salem?
No, I was in my 30s when I moved here, and it was totally by chance. I knew I wanted to be on the North Shore of Boston, but I had no particular desire to be in Salem. And like many other people, I now say I count my blessings that it was just a stroke of luck that this is where I landed.
Well, and I fell in love with it too. You know, I was there for a day, and it just infatuated with me, and also the history of it. So just to kind of get that out of the way, let's talk about the Salem witch trials. And we all know what we learned in school, but what are the misconceptions and what's the real truth about the witch trials?
Well, probably the first thing that everybody needs to realize is that there were no witches. No one was a witch. There were many people who were accused of witchcraft, and 20 people who were actually executed, most by hanging, but not all, and others who died in jail. before the hysteria died down, but no one was a witch. They were not burned at the stake, as many people think.
Right.
We have moved on from there.
So just a brief thing to follow up. So how long did the hysteria actually last there in Salem and the surrounding area?
Altogether, probably about a year and a half. It starts in the winter, say February-ish of 1692. The trials take place pretty much over the late spring and summer. The accusations and the events did not originally take place in Salem. They took place in what was called Salem Village, which was the agricultural part of town. It was the trials that took place in Salem town itself, which is why the name is there. Today, you can go to a memorial either in Salem or in modern day Danvers, which is where many of the actual events took place. But the executions took place. They began on June 10th with the hanging of Bridget Bishop, and they ended in September with the execution of the last six people.
Okay. So we talked about briefly before we came on the show about that Salem is much more than just the witch trials. But just briefly, let's talk about the whole month of October. Obviously, Salem... there are two components, I guess, in Salem, the people that really want to advertise the witch trials, and then the ones that want to deal with more of the historic history of Salem. Is that correct?
Yes and no. There are two Salems. So we talk about Witch City, which started in the 19th century and really was the beginning of the commercialization of Salem and all of the Halloween and the occult and people walking around in black robes and hats and telling fortunes and all of that aspect of it. We have a statue to Samantha. So that whole Witch City thing, that's what brings most people to Salem. And when they get here, they're very surprised to find that there is a whole nother side to it, which is the serious side of what happened to people who were unjustly accused and punished because of the failure of the legal system. So it isn't necessarily an either or. The two right. sort of have to live side by side. And then as you already mentioned, there's so much more to Salem that people discover, even if they initially come here for the witches.
So what do you think is the most important thing that if you could say one thing about Salem, Massachusetts, what would it be? What's the one thing that you think just sticks out as the most important thing about Salem?
If you want to put everything all together, it is a cultural treasure trove, whether you're talking about the history of the trials, whether you're talking about architecture, whether you're talking about maritime history, whether you are talking about modern museums, contemporary museums, restaurants, et cetera. It's just, there are many literary societies. There's so much going on here that makes it a very unusual place for a city of 40,000.
Let's talk about the architecture for a second. What is special about the architecture in Salem?
Well, Salem was probably America's richest city around 1800, slightly before that, just slightly after. 10% of the entire country's tax revenues came through Salem. And as a result, there was a lot of money here and a lot of very beautiful federal houses were built during that period from the 1790s up to probably the federal period up to 1820. And then even beyond that, I mean, there is still old sea captain money, shall we call it, maritime money, in some of the old families in Salem. So it has just a wealth of federal architecture.
Interesting.
And you also had Georgian, I should say, you know, before Georgia. 1800. So it's an interesting city architecturally, both homes and things like assembly halls.
So you had mentioned in the notes that you had sent me that America's first millionaire was from there or lived there. And who was that?
This is Elias Haskett Derby. We have a Derby Street in Salem. We have a Derby Wharf. This is around the turn of the century. He is reputed to have been America's first millionaire. There were probably another 10 or 12 men who were millionaires by 1800. So when I say this was an incredibly wealthy, sophisticated, cosmopolitan city, I'm not exaggerating.
So how far from Boston is Salem if you're driving in a car?
Maybe 20, 25 miles. So if you were to drive it at the middle of night, you could be there in half an hour. With modern day traffic, you need to allow a lot more time.
So how did Salem compare to the to the wealth of Boston? Was it obviously, what was the comparison back then?
Salem is older than Boston. Salem was founded in 1626. And at the time of the Revolutionary War and after that, it was probably more important. But Boston gradually overtakes it. It has a better harbor. As the ships got bigger, Salem's harbor couldn't compete. And then the war, Jefferson's embargoes kept Salem ships in port. This is in 1807. So nobody could conduct trade. And then it was followed by the War of 1812, which was like putting nails in the coffin. And Salem never really recovered as an economic power after that. By then, the Erie Canal had connected the middle part of the country to the Hudson River and down to New York, and the railroad was taking people to Boston. So both Boston and New York quickly overtook Salem.
Interesting. You had talked about the maritime history of Salem, and what would be some interesting aspects of the maritime history concerning
Salem? Well, it was captains or ships from Salem that were the first Americans to go to West Africa, the first Americans to go to the East Indies, the first Americans to go to Russia, the first Americans to many places. Not quite sure why, but these were intrepid young men. If they were good, they were captains of vessels before they were 20 years old. Many of them actually retired from active sea duty before they were 30.
Wow.
And they formed maritime societies in part to take care of the families, the widows and orphans of men who were lost at sea. In part also to share their navigational information. Something I never knew until I lived here was that before the Revolution, Americans were not allowed to engage in what's called the deep water trade, crossing the ocean. I mean, South America, as long as you kept the shore in sight. Anything that crossed the ocean had to come on an English ship. So after the Revolution, we can go anywhere in the world, but basically we don't know how to get there.
Right.
So they had these societies. So one of their mandates was you had to keep a journal. You had to make maps and drawings and share all of this information. And that's how they got started. And then actually the Peabody Essex Museum's parent organization was one of these societies, the East India Marine Society. And what made it different from the others was that they also said that they wanted to collect natural and artificial curiosities from around the world. Because this is a big thing, you know, even today there's a little bit of a chip on the shoulder towards Europe and England among Americans. But back after the Revolution, it's like there's a big desire to say we are not country bumpkins. We can stand up with the best of them. We're educated, we're cultured, and so they start collecting things. It's also to demonstrate this and to show the people back home where they've been and what they've seen.
So you mentioned the Peabody Essex Museum, and I, from my understanding, it's an incredible museum. I've never been there. What are some of the highlights that are in the museum itself?
Well, it does have all, I mean, it's the oldest continually operating museum in the country.
Oh, I didn't know that. Wow.
It was established in 1799 as the East India Marine Society. And in the 1990s, what was then called the Peabody Museum of Salem merged with the Essex Institute. The Essex Institute is where all of the records of the witch trials were kept, where they were pretty much documenting what happened on land, the social history, the furniture, the decorative arts, its painting, whereas the Peabody Museum of Salem had been pretty much been a maritime museum. So today you have this incredible wealth of a collection. It's like a mini Smithsonian. Plus, also today you have all the historic houses that are part of the museum, and it's very much a contemporary art museum with a lot of very innovative programming. It is increasingly being recognized as one of the most important in the country.
I've actually started following the museum on Instagram. So when we post this, I'll also include posts of how people can follow the museum and find out more about that.
Great.
So let's get back to one thing. So Halloween is coming up. What is a night of Halloween in Salem, Massachusetts really like?
Well, I was downtown last night, and here we are still, 10 days away from Halloween?
Yes.
Many of the major streets downtown are closed off, open only to pedestrian traffic.
Wow.
There is a carnival. There is a kids' carnival on the common. The downtown pedestrian mall is lined with pop-up tents. People are walking around in costumes. There are balls. There are seances. There are all sorts of things going on. There's, you know, the pet costume. There's the pumpkin walk. I mean, it starts literally with the first Thursday, and it builds. By the time they are estimating this year that by the time Halloween actually arrives, 1 million people will have visited Salem.
Oh my gosh.
You can't even get downtown on Halloween night. It is literally a zoo.
So
you can't park anywhere. I mean, all of the surrounding residential neighborhoods have big orange, no parking.
Right.
They come in by the hordes. If you're driving, it'll be backed up on the highways for a couple of miles to even get off the highway.
Wow.
So it becomes quite a festive occasion. And then here's something that's really interesting. You can't tell that I love Salem, but everybody goes home. But they end with fireworks around 10:30 or 11, trying to keep it family oriented.
Right.
The next morning, the cleanup crews will have already been out, and you will not be able to tell that anything had been going on.
That's like New York City for the New Year's Eve. By the next day, everything is cleaned up. It's amazing.
The only thing that's left are the porta potties. It takes a couple of days to tote those away.
So
it's quite incredible.
So how many people on a regular day, how many people actually live in Salem?
About 40,000.
Really? Okay.
42, 38, I don't know, some around 40,000.
And does the tourism, because we both know it's really cold in Massachusetts in the wintertime, as you sit there with a scarf on right now and me in a tank top, is the tourism like year-round steady, or does it peak and have valleys?
This is the big month. A lot of retailers, this is their make or break month,
right,
in October. However, Salem is dependent on tourism. We don't really have a lot of industry left. At one time we had mills, we had all sorts of things, but now it's very much tourism based, and it's not as busy as October, but throughout the summer,
right,
very much so. And the city has worked hard. There is some sort of major event every month, from Chocolate Festival, Salem So Sweet in February, to a poetry, the state poetry festival in May. There's something all going on all the time. If you want to come to Salem, you need to make reservations early. If you want to come and stay in Salem during September, October, you need to reserve a room a year in advance.
Wow. That's crazy. So do you go out on Halloween night, or do you stay home, or do you get out of the city?
I tried getting out of the city once. That was it. I do have friends that actually leave town. I mean, it's very difficult to go downtown during October. Right. I mean, the traffic gets worse and worse. Now I stay home. I want to see the trick-or-treaters. And they're done. I might walk downtown just to see what's going on.
Right, right.
But I've lived here a while, so I don't do it every year.
That's kind of like when I lived in Memphis on Elvis Dead Week. Yeah, occasionally. But the traffic was horrible there, too, and it's like you didn't want to deal with it. The other interesting note that you had was that the descendants of the Salem witches, so to speak, not really witches, but you said there was around 20 million people today that claim to be descendants. Mm-hmm. And are any of those people that you, are there any verified descendants that the museum knows about?
Oh, there are a lot of people who claim to be descendants. The Salem Witch Trials Museum downtown, and you can see it if you go to voicesagainstinjustice.org. They are the stewards of the Witch Trials Memorial. It's a beautiful memorial that has, in effect, a stone bench for each person who was executed. And you can walk through the memorial on many, many days, and you'll find that a descendant has left a note or right. flowers or something else. I think my comment to you was many people, quote, think they're special in some way. But really, with 20 million people out there, and then the other aspect is that if you're not the descendant of somebody who was accused, there's a good chance you're a descendant of an accuser.
Right, exactly.
Somebody on the other side.
Interesting enough, a few years ago, and I've been wanting to expand on that, was that I found that one of our ancestors actually lived near about 10 miles from Salem during that time period. So I've wanted to kind of investigate that more and see, you know, what that person's life, if I could, was interrelated with that.
You should check, because we talk about the Salem witch trials, but the people who were accused could have lived 30 or 40 miles away.
Okay.
I mean, this is, these accusations went as far as southern Maine.
So what was the circumference?
Andover, Massachusetts probably had more people accused than any
really?
Other. Yeah, but they're brought to Salem for trial.
Okay, got it.
And that's why the name has stuck with Salem.
So why were the trials then held in Salem? Because it was a bigger city than all the other towns?
Yes, it was the most largest and the most important town at the time.
Okay.
Like, you know, the county seat.
So here's, if a person wanted to read a book about Salem, what would be the best book you would recommend?
There are very many of them.
Putting
I would
you on the spot
probably
there.
One by Dr. Tad Baker, Salem Possessed. Well, actually, hold on. I've got them right here. Salem Possessed, A Storm of Witchcraft, Anything by Marilyn Roach, R-O-A-C-H. I can send you a list of...
Yes, do that.
Key titles and authors. They're... three or four people who basically anything they write is worth reading. But I think probably Tad Baker and Marilyn Roach. She wrote Six Women is her latest book on six specific women during the trials.
Okay, wonderful. Well, thank you so much for having this conversation with me. I hope that it sheds light on the city of Salem to anyone that listens to this podcast, and they understand that Salem is much more than just basically a year and a half of its existence. It has such a rich history. But thank you so much. And
thank you for asking.
Shelby sent me a list of books if you're interested in learning more about Salem, the Salem City or Salem, the Salem Witch Trials. The first one is A Storm of Witchcraft by Emerson Tad Baker or anything else by him. Another book is Anything by Marilyn Roach. Her latest is Six Women of Salem, and I think that is, it's a few years old. In the Devil's Snare by Mary Beth Norton. Some general books on Salem the city are A Maritime Salem in the Age of Sail, and it's by the National Park Service. and also The Death of an Empire, The Rise and Murderous Fall of Salem, America's Richest City by Robert Booth. This one is relatively new. Shelby says she's not read it yet, but she does recommend it. And then The Peabody Sisters by Megan Marshall. Don't worry, I will put all of these books in the show notes. And I will also, I have a list on my Amazon account that's a public list that I will list any books that I talk about in any of my podcasts. So I'll have a link to that as well so that you can go directly and purchase those if you so wish. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. I appreciate you listening. And if you would like, we would love for you to subscribe to our podcast. And you can listen to my podcast anywhere that you listen to podcasts. We're on iTunes, Google Play Music. If you have an iPhone, if you just go to the podcast app and click on the search find and type in A Southern Girl's View by Sandy Adams, then it will take you directly to the podcast and you can subscribe there. Thank you so much for listening. Have a wonderful weekend.